Live from the Gray Eagle in Asheville, the Pearl of Carolina, this is the Travis Book Happy Hour. With your special guest, Mimi Naja. And the Happy Hour House Band featuring Lyndsay Pruett. And now, your host, Travis Book. Thank you. And thank you, Lyndsay. Welcome to the Happy Hour. My name is Travis Book. This is how it goes tonight. We'll see what unfolds. I'm so happy to have Mimi here. I've known Mimi for a long, long time. I'm a huge fan of her and her band, and what an interesting time to be alive, you know? I mean, it's just flabbergasting, really. What it means to be, alive and an American and a citizen of the world right now. It's bizarre, but I have a lot of hope because I don't really know any other way, and avoidance and denial is my favorite coping strategy. So here's a song.
Take a train, catch a flight, go ahead and it'll be alright. No one that you owe it to, you'll do what you want to do. Start the car, leave tonight, go ahead and it'll be alright. We'll still be here, it'll be alright. Drive out past the city lights, watch the day turn in the night. You'll be feeling better by midnight. A winding road will make it right. Go ahead, it'll be alright. What is past is done, no use holding on, don't look back. That old house is gone, the ground it rested on. Turn out that light and don't look back, it'll be all right. Better take your chances when they come. Don't wait for something or someone. Hate to miss a chance at life. Go ahead, and it'll be alright. Still be here, but it'll be alright. I
don't actually know if that's true. I don't know if it's going to be all right, but I assume that it will be. I think that you kind of just function under the assumption that everything's going to work out fine, right? Otherwise, you're just sort of locked in a never-ending trap of anxiety. Anybody know about that? I actually started experiencing anxiety this week for the first time in a really long time, and it's a miracle it took this long, given our current corona crises and my sort of general lack of trajectory and direction. This is the first week I actually had anxiety, and it was because I think I had probably too much going on, which is a really good problem to have, but I do know a little bit about this anxiety that we're all feeling. So, man, you know, I tend to try to build these shows around some kind of a theme, give us something to anchor ourselves in, and Mimi suggested travel, because we can't travel anymore, and because so much of our lives are built around that. So I've got some, sometimes I do a little bit of a monologue here, and I'm going to share some thoughts. I read this quote today. It said, one of the best side effects of travel is that it makes you modest. You see what a tiny space you occupy in the world. And I think when you see how small you are, it also tempers any sense you have of you or as I say, like of yours, like your family or your city or your country. You lose the sense that you're exceptional as an individual, right? And at the same time, obviously we are all exceptional, perfect, beautiful, amazing beings, created however you believe we're created, but the sort of the flip side of that also is that we are all completely insignificant and nothing. And in terms of a giant species, zoom out at like a special perspective, none of us really matter that much, you know? And so trying to sort of hold those two things, those two ideas simultaneously, I think a lot of what we're finding is a lot of hubris and people feeling like their ideas, themselves, their rights, my shit is important and matters. And, you know, you have to believe that you matter so that you have a purpose in your life, but it's also, I think it's also valuable to sort of remember that in the grand scheme of things, you just don't really matter that much, right? Is that an okay thing to say? Like, don't take it personally, but you don't matter. I wrote this down here. I don't know if this makes any sense, but I'm gonna read it anyway. Much like how cultivating a sense of what is referred to as the witness creates space between your thoughts and your perception of reality. You with me there? Like, you can stand back from your own thoughts and sort of witness the unfolding of your own like microcosm. You can get trapped in your thoughts, or you can step back from it. Much like you can sort of cultivate the witness and stand behind your thoughts, travel does sort of the same thing, where it allows you to sort of zoom out. You get out of your well-worn tracks. You know, like, sometimes I feel like I drive into my own driveway and I don't even really see my house anymore. I see, it's just a bunch of projected sort of memories about what my house is, right? And so you take we all have these, you know, you know how it is, like you're supposed to go somewhere, but you drive out of your driveway and you just go the same way that you always go. Pretty soon you realize, you're like, where the hell am I driving? I'm like driving to work on Saturday, you know, and you find yourself in these ruts. Nothing like travel to help break you out of that and give you that perspective, sort of like cultivating the witness in your own mind. You travel and you start to realize that, like, yeah, my hometown is great and, you know, but it's a beautiful world, right? And every community is amazing and everybody matters and everybody has value, and they also don't matter at the same time. I digress. I'm gonna play another. I'll play a tune here about travel. This is a tune I learned from. I haven't called him this yet, but he can only really be described as my mentor. His name's Benny Galloway. We call him Burl, and he's done a lot of good, done a lot of harm. He's sent a lot of us young men into the bluegrass trenches without a helmet, but with lots of training. So I learned this one from Benny Galloway. It's a Sean Camp tune.
California, leaving shadows on the ground. like clouds above. My way back through Arizona, I began to pine in for you. The red rocks run, blew beside me along my way. Just like me, they'd like to travel, but they won't sit still. Listen, I do, and I can't sit still until I get back to you. Yeah, pick me up like some hitchhiker. Let me ride into the wild and blue. I don't care which way I'm going, long as that's the way you're going to. Hey, I am the man with the traveling teardrop. And the me makes her face up with a look. Some old warrior in her eye. There in the dark, behind the curtain, on the bed of lust, I loved her while she slept. Left the tea to say goodbye. Yeah, pick me up like some hitchhiker. Let me ride into the wild and blue. I don't care which way I'm going, long as that's the way you're going to. Hey, I am the man with the traveling teardrop blue. Said I am the man with a traveling teardrop blue. Said I am the man with a traveling teardrop blue.
Thank you, and thank you, Sean Camp, for that amazing song. Sean Camp, so underrated. So funny, so great. I'm gonna beat this thing into tune. And then I think I have more to say. But don't worry, Mimi's coming soon. Mimi has things to say, too. Let's see here. Let me... Oh, this is fun. Here, let me get in tune. You know, today, it's been an interesting couple of days. I believe it's a full moon. I don't know how that affects anybody else out there, but... Man, That shit makes everything weird. You know, the kids act weird. I act weird. It's just weird. Like, if it's not weird enough already, we got full moon to deal with. Okay, cool, I'm in tune. I have more thoughts. So travel can also be a journey, right? And journeys are in space and time, but they are also of the mind and of the spirit, right? So the journey toward knowing oneself and one's purpose, or a journey toward like an awakened state of life, is it's a lifelong pursuit, right? It doesn't end. It also is unfolding moment to moment, right? Because it doesn't happen there. We talked about this with Lindsay Liu a couple weeks ago, like the eternal now. What time is it? Now, where are you? You're here, right? So it's an ongoing thing, but it's also happening moment by moment. We can only go day by day, expanding our awareness of ourselves and our capacity for compassion. Birth is the beginning of this trip. Death is the destination, right? How fun, how sort of remarkable and kind of strange, you know? And for a lot of people, like, so for me, the question sort of becomes what to do on the trip. And I feel like that's really so much of what spirituality and its sort of like little ugly brother religion is oriented toward. It's like trying to figure out, like, what do we do? Like, that's where the rubber hits the spiritual road, right? Like, so what do we do? And why are we here? And what happens when we die? And none of us know. And no one can know. And it's totally far out. I just find that so fascinating. I mean, just like you can't, we were talking about backstage, like, is there anything that you can really know? You know? And just when you thought you knew, then like there's an election and it completely, there's like a figure ground reversal, or like you think things are a certain way and then there's this coronavirus and everything that you thought to be true, it calls everything into question. It just goes to show you that like we just really don't know shit. Sunrise on the South Lake, summertime in Georgia, beaches by the dozen, won't you be my kissing cousin, East California, getting off of this train, give me some wings, give me some wings, give me some wings, give me some wings. Next stop, sunny Southland, sugar worth tasting. Look, if you can find him, he owes me, you remind him. Tell him time's a-wasting. If he can get me off of this train, give me some wings, give me some wings, give me some wings. Give me some wings. You'd better use them. Better yet, don't lose them. You think you'd learn by now and not be gone. Wings are made for angels. Little hard to handle. About enough to get you lost, but not back home. God bless the sunny Southland. Paradise is calling. Always sunny weather in the winter, or whenever you catch me when I'm falling. What can I say? It's just one of them things. Give me some wings, give me some wings, give me some wings. Give me some wings. Get your wings, you better use them. Better yet, don't lose them. You think I'd learn by now and I'd be gone. Wings are made for angels. A little hard to handle. About enough to get you lost, but not back home. Yeah, you missed that sunny Southland. You wanted to leave her. When you're broke enough for fixing, bring on the Mason-Dixon. It's easy to believe her. Gonna be there when she sings. Give me some wings, give me some wings, give me some wings. Give me some wings, give me some wings, give me some wings.
Yeah, give me some ways, give me some ways, be some ways, give me some ways, give me some ways. Yeah.
All right. Thank you so much. The Travis Book Happy Hour is brought to you by generous donations from our supporting listeners. That's you, listeners. You can make contributions. Donations cover all the expenses here at the Travis Book Happy Hour. You can make your donations through Venmo at Travis Book or paypal.me/TravisBook1. Support live music, support Lyndsay Pruett, and support Asheville. Thank you. All right, I'd like to welcome my first guest, my only guest, from the band Fruition, from the planet Earth, from the entire cosmos, please, Mimi Naja.
Hi, everybody. We are in a venue right now. Wow.
Yes, we are.
Wow. It's really something.
Is this your first time doing gigs?
I mean, it's my first time doing gigs in real venues with crowds in them. I've done a couple of streams, but there's never been anyone in the room.
Hey, let's be clear. This is not a crowd.
Oh, come on.
Okay.
Rude. I see you. I see you.
Here's a crowd. I had a feeling someone was going to say that, like as soon as I said it. I just want all of you listening and watching at home to know that we're not crowded in here. We are observing Carolina State guidelines and keeping ourselves distanced because it's important that we stay socially distanced, we wear our masks,
audience.
We wash our hands.
We have an audience.
Oh, you bet your ass we do.
There we go.
And we got the best
it's
audience in America right here.
It's just a word thing.
So, Mimi, I'm so glad you came over. You're living in Nashville, right?
I'm living in Nashville.
And you were in Portland.
Yeah, but I was here for a little while.
Yeah.
In Asheville, baby. I did the Ash to Nash connection, you know?
Ooh.
That is a thing. I just said so.
I think I saw that one time on the internet.
So besides getting to hang with you and play music, it was an easy yes to say yes to coming here. I love it here. I spent all day... First I went straight to Taco Billy, and then I grabbed way too many tacos, and I just drove the parkway all day, and it was glorious.
Yeah, for those of you who don't know, the Blue Ridge Parkway is incredible. It's usually vies for top three of the most visited national parks in the country, and it's the kind of thing, it would never happen now, because the government had to take over a ton of land. A lot of people are still really bitter about it. Much like the history of this country, a little murky when you start looking back at it. But the end result is pretty sweet. Blue Ridge Parkway is awesome.
The end result is a gift, you know? I mean, that's one of the ways that I think the government being involved is a good thing because it's protect. I was thinking about it today. I was thinking how great it is that, you know, there aren't a bunch of, like, built-up developments happening. It's just for cruising. It's just for enjoying and cruising and not for profit.
Just for getting those views and doing the most American thing you can do, which is burn that petrol, baby.
That's right.
Burn that petrol. Drill, baby, drill.
It hurts because it's true.
It hurts because it's so true. So what have you been up to? You haven't been traveling. You haven't been touring. What have you been doing?
I've been... playing lots of music at my house, you know? It's like when you mix your love and passion with your profession, sometimes that love can get a little lost when you're just like grinding the road really hard. And the same with traveling. Your love for traveling can get a little lost when you're just tired all the time.
When
it's all mixed in with it being your job, that gets kind of lost. So, I've been really enjoying falling in love with just playing music for me again. It's been amazing.
That's beautiful. That's yeah. I'm so happy to hear that. That's been a really similar experience for me too. You know, yeah. My role for so many years was just essentially as like a string duster. That was like basically the only thing I did musically.
It's
I played bass.
Your identity.
That's like all I had time for. The rest of the time I was like taking care of the kids and riding my bike. That's all the music I had time for. The great pause has afforded me the opportunity to play with all kinds of amazing musicians and to play some guitar and to be writing and doing all of these things. Coming back to sort of like so many of the things that I really love about music. It's, again, it's so easy. I mean, this ties back to what I was talking about earlier. It's so easy to sort of lose sight, but if you get a little bit of space from it, you zoom out, gives you a lot more appreciation for what you have.
Yes.
Helps you to really, you know, like my dad said, don't stress about what you can't do. Get into what you can.
Yeah, absolutely.
So do you miss the traveling?
I really do. You know, and I've been thinking a lot about what it will look like to go back to tour life, and I still come with a sense of gratitude for the great pause because it gave me some clarity on what I'm willing for it to look like when we go back, and not just grinding as hard as possible because we can. Like, I'm not 22 anymore. I can't do that. My yeah. body won't let me do that. And figuring out what does work for me, I think I would have just burnt out if this hadn't happened. So I'm trying to look at COVID as, I'm trying to put a gratitude lens on it as much as possible, even though it's really hard to do. But you know what I mean? When it does go back, when it is time to hit the road again, I think I'm just gonna have a lot more clarity on what I'm willing to do and how long I'm willing to do it, and how exhausted I'm willing to get just to get that gig.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah. So many assumptions we had. I mean, I think it's so easy to be like, oh yeah, if you're in a band, you just grind. You just go play, like, more gigs is better. More gigs is better. Always, always, always more gigs. And that may still hold true, but that model is less appealing to me now than it was before.
For sure.
Yeah. Yeah. So you grew up in Atlanta.
I did. Yeah.
You're a daughter of the South.
Absolutely. Georgia Peach.
Indeed. Then you moved to Portland.
Yeah, I did. I used this great private liberal arts college as an excuse to get out there, and then I got kicked out and started a band.
I hear that, girl. Yeah.
Man, and I'm so grateful. I'm grateful for that I got kicked out, because now I don't have student loans.
Dude, I did not realize we had this in common. Because,
oh, sweet, really?
Because I, too, was kicked out of my liberal arts school before I had the luxury of racking up debt.
Yeah, where'd you go?
I was at Fort Lewis College in Durango. We also call it Fort Leisure.
Yeah, sounds right.
Harvard on the Hill.
Okay.
But, you know, really great place to go and be a ski bum, turns out,
yeah,
and play
no
bluegrass.
Doubt.
So
definitely great for that.
That's interesting that
I find it funny, too, that, you know, I'm from Georgia, but I'm from Atlanta, so like I didn't play bluegrass until I moved out west and got down with the West Coast hippies who love bluegrass. You know, I was listening to like Outkast growing up. It's like, oh, you're from Georgia, that's why you play mandolin. It's like, no, nope.
Right, like you're from Georgia. You're like, well, I'm from Atlanta.
Yeah,
you
know, it's very, like, it's very a different situation.
It's a little bit of a distinction there between the two. So your band, you're in Fruition, which is just an amazing band.
Thanks.
And you guys have been a band for how long?
We've been a band since I got kicked out of college.
No.
We've been officially Fruition with a combo with Jay. It started with Jay and Kellen since February of 2008.
Awesome. And we're so lucky that you guys found each other.
Oh, yes.
Because your band is so cool.
We feel so lucky.
So you started out more as like more of a string band vibe.
We were a string band vibe. You know, we were a folk band. We were a sidewalk busking band. So, you know, acoustic instruments is what we could do. So even though we don't come from a traditional grass background at all, that's the kind of instrumentation that worked for the sidewalk. And our very, very loud singing voices.
Yes. Busker
special. That's how we started, was the sidewalk. It was good to us.
Sweet, but now you're basically an electric rock band.
Straight up.
So how... I mean, so I know the answer to this question. but I'm going to ask it anyway.
Okay, great.
Why the transition, and how did that come about?
I think the whole thing is just, like I said, starting so grassroots, you know? We didn't start bluegrass. We started grassroots. If we could have always had the space and the electricity, you know, to be a full-on rock band or rock, you know, instrumentation, that would have happened. You know, there were times like T-Tom would, you know, stuff some formation of a kit into a big kick drum and walk to our busking spot with that. So we always worked hard to get what we could, but it was all just, we used our limitations, you know? And then when we didn't have limitations because we convinced venues to let us in and plug in, we got to do, it's not, I wouldn't say what we actually wanted, it just kind of grew out of not having the limitations anymore.
Right, yeah. That's really cool. Yeah, I mean, a lot of times I assume, like sometimes I feel like I only play acoustic music just because like I don't have anybody to play electric music with.
Right.
So anytime I play with a drummer, I'm like, oh yeah, this is where it's at.
Yeah,
you
no
know?
Doubt.
Like the Dusters played before, like last fall, I think we played with the rhythm section, the drummers from String Cheese Incident.
Oh yeah, dude.
And that was, like, it was kind of awesome. It was actually amazing, but it was, you know, the band got off stage and we're kind of looking at each other and we're like, shit.
Now it's just us again.
We're like, shit. Now what are we gonna do? Because it was really sweet.
Yeah, I feel that when we have, if we have like a horn section sit in or something, and then you're like, oh, all three of you don't fit in the van, but there's something missing now. I want that brass.
Yep.
Yeah, I know what you mean.
Yep. You guys are 6-piece, right?
How many of us are there? We're a 5-piece.
No, you're just 5.
TLP makes 6.
Oh, our yeah, do not forget TLP.
Can't forget TLP.
Sweet. So you're a 5-piece. That's good. That's good symmetry. I always warn people against being in 6-piece bands.
That's a lot of human.
Oh, yeah. It's a lot of everything, except for getting paid.
Yeah, exactly.
You know?
Exactly. Yeah, I have so much respect for, like, the big, like, 10-piece funk bands that do it. I'm like, I don't know how you do it for all the reasons, but I'm thankful for you.
Yeah, I am, too. Anytime I see a big band, I'm like, thank God you like living in a cardboard box, because this is awesome. You guys are killing it.
I'm dancing now.
There's no way you're getting paid enough money for rent, but God, this is killing right now. Couple more questions, and then I'm going to let you have the floor.
Cool, man.
And play us some music. What are you afraid of?
Jeez. Who is this guy? What am I afraid of?
I told you if I made you uncomfortable, you could turn it around on me. Although no, I'm not prepared to answer this question.
That's what vulnerability is all about. You gotta get uncomfortable. I mean, lately I've been working really hard and struggling to feel fully safe. I don't feel safe in this country. I don't feel safe. I love cities, and I don't feel safe in my city. I don't feel safe in most cities. I feel like there's a ticking time bomb everywhere I turn, and like, I think a lot about like gun culture, and that scares me a little bit. I don't want to get into all of that, but it's just like that plays into my ability to just feel safe just going about my day, you know? So yeah, thanks Travis for asking me that.
You want to just sit over there and marinate on that for
a
minute?
No, I don't.
Get sadder? All right, well, how about this? Let me back that up with what makes you happy?
Being with buds like you makes me happy. Oh. Burning gasoline on the Blue Ridge Parkway makes me really happy.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, songs, you know, feeling seen makes me really happy.
Ah, and heard.
Yeah.
Right.
I feel a little bit of safety when I feel seen. So there you go. See how I brought those together for you?
I do, and I really want to dig in more to this, but I feel like I'm a little out of my element with this one.
I feel like I should just
because
end at a good note.
Yeah, well,
we don't want to spiral.
Yeah, I mean, it's supposed to be the happy hour, right? But let's
I'm happy.
Let's talk about, you know, feeling like, let's talk about feeling afraid. Because it's interesting because, you know, I'm a, like, let's run down the list. Like, I'm like a white American male born to a middle class family. It is incredibly challenging for me to understand what it's like to be almost any other segment of our society is marginalized or at a disadvantage or in a less advantageous place than someone like me, right? When you want to talk about white privilege,
yeah,
like, I'm the fucking poster boy for it, right? And it doesn't give me a lot of perspective mm-hmm. on what it's like to not feel safe.
Well, I can tell you this: I'm a half Middle Eastern queer woman from the South, and I haven't felt truly unsafe until 2020. That's messed up, dude. I like made it through like terrifying youthful ages and like the cruelty of like middle and high school energy. And I haven't felt these feelings until now. What's up with that?
Well, the hopeful and optimistic part of me, which is basically all that's left, because I squashed the rest of it.
Nice.
I buried it deep down. The hopeful and optimistic part of me wants to say that this sort of discomfort that we're feeling as a culture is sort of part and parcel with what happens before you experience a major shift.
Yes,
and,
I agree.
And that is what keeps bringing me back to a place of hope. And I don't want to get political, not because I'm trying to collect tips and donations from all political people. I don't want to get political because I don't want to alienate anybody, and I know that as soon as someone turns off the stream, the conversation is over, right? So I try to avoid getting political, but God, and what was I going to say now? I guess I avoided it so hard I forgot.
Well, like the big awakenings and big transitions and big changes, that's the whole thing, is for them to happen, it's always at some expense, so at what expense, you know?
Yeah.
Well, Human lives.
And when things sort of creep along incrementally, it's sort of like the analogy of like you put a frog in a pot and you start the burner.
Right.
You'll boil that thing alive because
right.
It won't realize. But you drop it in the boiling pot, it's going to jump right out. And so maybe 2020 is sort of the boiling pot.
I definitely feel like that frog.
Yeah. Well, although I would say, man, I mean, it still feels pretty complacent. Like, I'm not sure what frog we are. I'm not sure that the water is boiling quite enough because, you know, it felt like things were kicking in pretty hard. And now it kind of feels like we're just kind of like we're back to like musicians begging for gigs and people like, you know, just like back to like first world problems again.
Well, there's a lot of parallel things happening at once, you know, just like that's happening internally too. You can feel multiple feelings at once, you know, there's just...
Totally. You can hold...
There's dominant feelings and, you know...
You can hold multiple truths to be true.
Exactly.
Like, it's so... Man, just like I said when I started the show, like, what an amazing time to be alive.
It's really true.
It's just... If you're looking for an interesting time, it's pretty juicy right now. Like, you... You picked a good time to incarnate. Well done, everybody. Hope we all make it.
It's juicy.
Hey, Mimi, will you play us some music?
I would love to play
all
songs.
Right. Everybody.
Yeah.
The
Thanks.
Incomparable Mimi Naja.
Thank you. Thanks, Travis.
Yes. Mimi, take it away. Give us some hope. I'm sorry. I can't take it back, but give us some hope.
I'm sorry, it's here.
Thanks so much for being here, Mimi.
Oh.
That sounds like the one. The key of C for California. We're going with this travel theme, you know? And usually about this time of year, I would have been to the West Coast 3 or 4 times by now. I have zero regrets about moving back to the South. It feels great to be here. But I have a lot of love for the West Coast. I just love this great nation. But here's a song, here's a Wilco song for you. Take a little transport to the west side of things. Right now. Yeah, I was talking about the Blue Ridge Parkway, and I was like, it's really second only to Highway 1, really, as my favorite American drives. Might be tied for first, though. They're very different things, but they just make me feel good. Let's see here. Let's take it down to New Orleans. New Orleans has given me the best and worst nights of my life. Yeah! This is a Mason Jennings song. It gives you a little bit of that. It's a sort of love story gone wrong, but it's got all that beautiful New Orleans charm, so. And there's a whole lot of lyrics. That's why I'm cheating. Dust cloud coming off an old dirt road leads up here to this little graveyard. Seven lights in a perfect row. Under each light is a police car. Just because you say it doesn't make it true. You can say I'm guilty, man, I just don't care. You can burn my body black, just don't make me go back to Jackson Square. I met you on Decatur Street with your little bare feet and your violin. I was walking by with my guitar in my hands. You smiled at me and I jumped right in. Before I knew it, you were all I knew. Every moment together was an answered prayer. After a while, we had some money saved up. We rented a room over Jackson Square. One day, everything changed. Your eyes got strange, you didn't seem yourself. Go to tell a story and you start out fine. Halfway through it, you'd be somewhere else. I started having the strangest dream. I held a string and looked up in the air. And you were glowing with the strangest light. Went out of sight over Jackson Square. Life is something that you can't control. Try to hold on to it, it makes you let go. Things are not like they were before. I can hear her crying through an open window. She sees spirits all around the room, telling her things that make her feel scared. I got no idea what to do. We're both in over our heads on Jackson Square. Up with a weight on my chest. People were screaming on the street below. I reached for you, I was alone in a bed. Wind was blowing through an open window. Suddenly I was very old, in a little boat, absolutely nowhere. Staring at the side of the universe and your tiny body down on Jackson Square. Now don't tell me that there ain't no wind. The damn well is, and it waits in the wings. I see you kneeling there at center stage, in your tiny cage made of angel wings. Well, I'm here every night, loading my gun and trying not to go there. Anyone that thinks that life is clear has never seen a mirror or been to Jackson Square. Seen a mirror or been to Jackson Square. I heard that. Thank you very much. It's so nice to play for y'all. Thanks for being such a nice crowd. I mean, audience. Part of not really being able to travel too much is when you have to stay home, not leave your house too much. It's kind of hard to meet people, you know what I'm saying? It's kind of hard to, like, date. So here's an old song. It's by Richard Berry. Just to find a little girl that loves me so. Thank you very much. I decided to end it like that. Let's get the friends back up. Please give it up for Lyndsay Pruett. And our wonderful host, Travis Book. Sweet to play with my friends again.
Tune by the father of bluegrass.
Too long, and I feel like I gotta travel on. Yeah. Thank you. Lyndsay Pruett on fiddle. Woo.
All right, that's Mimi Naja, everybody. Fantastic. We're going to take a short break, and we'll be back in 60 seconds with more music. Welcome back to the Travis Book Happy Hour. I'm Travis Book. With me tonight, Mimi Naja, and the Happy Hour house band, Lyndsay Pruett on the fiddle. Trailers for sale rent, rooms to let 50 cents. No phone, no pool, no pets. I ain't got no cigarettes, but 2 hours of a bush and a broom. Buys an 8x12 4-bedroom. I'm a man of means, by no means a king of the road. Midnight train, destination Bangor, Maine. Oh, worn out suit and shoes. I don't pay no union dues. I smoke old doobies that I found. Short, but not too big around. I'm a man of means, by no means a king of the road. Ain't a lock when no one's around. I say trailers for sale or rent, rooms to let 50 cents. No phone, no pool, no pets. I ain't got no cigarettes, but 2 hours of a pushing broom. Buys an 8x12 4-bit room. I'm a man of means, Naja, the best bass player on the stage tonight. All right, yeah, I didn't grow up with a lot of country music, but man, I really like it.
Yeah.
A lot.
For sure.
And it turns.
Sing it real good.
Thank you. Yeah. It turns out I even like writing country songs.
Yeah.
And you know, if the String Dusters don't get back together soon, I might have to launch my Blake Shelton style career.
Oh, you mean that kind of country? I was gonna ask if
country singer.
I was gonna ask if you needed a bass player, but I'm gonna wait on that.
Going, oh, you'd be perfect.
You mean that kind of country?
Yeah, I mean, you know, if Kenny Chesney can do it, anyone can do it.
Oh, but you know that whole thing, just because you can doesn't mean you should.
Oh.
But also, no. I fully support it, actually. That's a little thing. I mean, I just moved to Nashville, for gosh sakes. Like, that's a little thing we call mailbox money. So I support it.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I think what's important is that you believe in what you do.
Yeah.
And so, you know.
And if what you do is get paid, I mean, that works out, right?
I mean, look, I'll write the songs and then you can all decide if they're any good or not. How about that? That's kind of my method.
I'm into it.
Yeah. Why don't you play us some actual music?
Oh, man, that's a lot of pressure, huh?
Yeah, and I wasn't insinuating anything about Kenny Chesney. I was let's play music instead of talking about music.
Oh, no, you dropped two different names, but that's a whole other thing. I'm not here to drag anybody.
Yeah, no, I mean,
Kenny Chesney's kind of awesome.
He is. He's also kind of hot.
Keith Urban's hot.
He, like me, has the kind of body that both men and women find attractive. So that's something else that Kenny and I have in common. And we were supposed to go back to the music several comments ago, so take it away, Mimi.
You can take a minute if you need to.
No, very serious, very serious.
Sun coming up over the Tennessee hill. Thinking about my baby, she knows how it feels to rise up singing and go down slow. Try not to think of all that's left to go. Nothing fancy, but not doing without. She got a job and a dog and a big empty bed. And I'm waiting for the day that I can rest my head beside you. About the days on
Thank you. This one's for you, bud.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah.
That's Stickley, and he seems like he can't believe it.
He's this song's biggest fan, and like that just warms my heart so much. What is this?
Whatever it is, you need it right now.
It's hemp. I think it's like a hemp kombucha or something.
Well, you are in Asheville.
Yeah, for sure. I was like, man, I'm 152 days sober right now. I was like, if I can get out of, thank you. If I can make it out of Asheville without caving to one of the million tasty beers here, I can do pretty much anything. So
yeah, there's so much beer here. It's almost like the alcohol like precipitates into the air, and you walk around Asheville and you just get drunk breathing. There's so much beer here.
That'll be your excuse.
Maybe that's why it's been so easy today. Anyway, here's another Fruition song here. All my friends are gone, and the sun is down. Shorter. Thank you so much.
I think that's my favorite Mimi song as well.
Let's travel to the land of enchantment.
Thank you very much. That's Mimi Naja, everyone. And now a word from our sponsors. This is the point at which we would thank any sponsors we had. We have one sponsor, Thompson Guitar. Thank you, Thompson Guitar. Pacific Northwest, fine handmade instruments. I'd also like to thank all of you for tuning in tonight, for donating. I want you to know that there's a lot more coming from the Travis Book Happy Hour. However, we have no idea when that will be, so stay tuned for announcements. All right, and we're back. Yes, wow. That was such a great commercial break. You really feeling that?
I was too.
Man.
Listening to Lyndsay and talking about guitars, I'm in.
Yeah, I mean, really, yeah. Maybe that's what the show should be.
Just that whole theme.
Is just... Did we play this tune in A?
An A.
Hey, I want to thank you all so much for tuning in tonight. Thank you to this wonderful studio crowded audience for being here tonight. You all were really great. I know that it's kind of weird, coming in and sitting in seats and having to keep your distance, and especially if you were expecting a regular concert and you came and you got this, I could see how you might be disappointed. So thank you so much for being patient. And, obviously, as always, huge thanks to the Grey Eagle for making this happen. Allowing us the space to do this. I didn't tell anyone because I was sort of embarrassed. But then I remembered that I don't do shame. So I don't have to worry about that anymore. Last week I showed up ready to go for the gig, and there was no one here. Staff wasn't here, name wasn't on the marquee. So the kitchen staff came out and they're like, "Hey man," I was sitting in the back playing guitar, they're like, "Hey man, are you trying to put on a show here tonight?" And I was like, "Yeah, did I not confirm it?" And they're like, "No."
Been there.
That was about an hour and 30 minutes before we went on the air. And the entire crew here pulled together. You know, everybody came out of the woodwork. Chris came down to run sound. Like, we all got it together and we put on the show. And that wouldn't have happened if it weren't for the amazing positive attitude of everyone here at the Grey Eagle. So thank you so much. And you know what we're going to do is we're going to leave you with a little tune. A little old-timey tune by Don Stover called Things in Life.
Look up, look down that lonesome road. Hang down your head and cry. For we often lose some things in life that make us wonder why. Sleeps beneath the clay, and I live in hopes and dreams of blue. Never meet again someday. And I often see. To be a small part of life, a for some few things to achieve. Just to know I've been a worthless cause would make my poor heart bleed. When they lower my casket down, it's a lonesome grave to rest, and you take one last look at my face, you can say I've done my best.
Thank you so much. Thanks for tuning into the Travis Book Happy Hour. Mimi Naja, Lyndsay Pruett, and I'm Travis Book. We will see you soon, someday down the road. Be good to each other, have compassion, stay hopeful. Because